works.
Thank you, Olga, very much. Thank you for the invitation one more time. I will share with you an EEG investigation that we are conducting about how bilinguals actually handle two writing systems when they are able to read in two different languages. So if we consider investigation in reading and visual word recognition processes in monolinguals, we know very well that we can distinguish between sublexical and lexical reading. The first one is very slow and inaccurate because it's done serially during just letter by letter, graphem to phonem decodem, whereas the lexical reading is much more fast and accurate because it's done through a visual word recognition strategy for the whole word. And actually, we know that readers are able to evolve from this sublexical to lexical reading very fast in a process so called lexicalization, and very, very fast they are able to adapt this whole word visual recognition strategy after just some exposures, which actually ensures the efficient communication in visual domain and actually the acquisition of new vocabulary and so on. But the question in this study is, what is happening with biliterate population, that bilinguals that can read also in a second language, and how they manage this? So if we consider previous literature, there is a vast evidence of cross-linguistic transfer effects between the first alphabet and the second during reading. And we know from this data that probably phonological representations in both alphabets, phonological representations are activated in parallel while reading, and actually, very possibly, they are integrated into the same lexical system. And if we consider these investigations, we know that there are some evidences for facilitatory effects from one alphabet to the other, probably led by orthographic consistency across both alphabets. Whereas there are also interference effects from one alphabet to the other, led by phonological inconsistencies across both. For example, if we consider Russian English bilinguals, there is actually a graphemic overlap across these two alphabets, Cyrillic and Roman. There are the same letters or the same graphemes, which actually are decoded into completely different phonemes across the alphabets. So this graphemic overlap and this ambiguity across alphabets actually slow down naming latencies in this Russian English population. This is what we know from behavioral studies, and our question here in this investigation is to examine the neurophysiological mechanisms underlying this bialphabetic reading, and actually particularly investigate this phonological ambiguity effect during the encoding of both novel and also familiar words. So our predictions are that this phonological inconsistency is going to interfere visual word recognition processes, and this is going to be shown in longer naming latencies, as actually has been already proved, and this is going to cause interference both at sublexical and lexical level, not only at behavioral data, but also at neurophysiological level. So what we expect is differences both in early and late brain responses. Particularly, we are focusing the first around 200 milliseconds, because in this time window, there is known to happen or to be related with the extraction of visual features, and actually with the wall form access during orthographic processing, both in indexes, this processing in N1, P1 complex, and also P200 component, which is that one that is highlighted in gray. And also it's possible that we are going to find some differences or some influence of this phonological incongruency in later time window, particularly encoded in N400 component, which is particularly known to reflect difficulties or more effortful processing during lexicosemantic stages. So what we did to test this is to recruit 24 Russian English biliterates in different heterogeneous levels of English proficiency, and we selected 24 stimuli, 12 novel, 12 familiar words, which were manipulated in three different script conditions. So if we see, we have a familiar or novel words in the first, in the native alphabet, in the second alphabet, so in Kyrillic or in English. And these are non-ambiguous conditions because the graphemes, the letters, are or particularly specific from one alphabet, or they are shared, but they are consistent into when they are written in one or another alphabet. Whereas the third condition, the ambiguous one, is inconsistent because the graphemes, they are shared, but they are inconsistently read across both alphabets. So what we did is to present this into a reading aloud task in which participants, they were reading continuously these words through 10 blocks. So we have in total 40 trials per condition. And during this reading aloud, we will record the continuous EEG signals with 64 active channels. And what we analyze both behavioral and neurophysiological data. Particularly, we use linear mixed effect models, and we choose lexicality and script as predictors, and we analyze as dependent variables naming latencies for behavioral data or the mean amplitude for the electrophysiological data. So for the behavioral, what we found is a lexicality by script interaction, which actually replicates previous findings, and is basically that there are differences in the naming latency between familiar and novel words, and this depends on the script. So what is happening is that familiar words, they show higher naming latencies, either in ambiguous and actually in second alphabet as well, in comparison to those presented in the native alphabet in Kyrillic. But novel words, they show the highest naming latencies in ambiguous in comparison to those presented in Roman, and in comparison to those presented in the native one. But the highest was in the ambiguous condition. And actually, if we consider or if we compare both familiar and novel, we found that actually, if you can see in the right part of the graph, in the ambiguity, in the ambiguous condition, the novel words in white, they show high, much more a strong effect of this phonological ambiguity than familiar words. This is just the replication of previous findings, and we want to explore this in detail in neurophysiological level. So first of all, what we did is to make a conduct visual inspection of the EEG signal, the global field power, and we decide to focus in two time windows, around 200 and around 400 milliseconds, to analyze the differences there across different topographic factors. And what we found is lexicality by script interactions at both early and late time windows. So for the early, as you can see here, there is a lexicality by script particularly found in the frontal region in comparison to posterior regions. And what is happening here is that only those familiar words, not novel, they are showing an enhancement of P200 for those conditions which are in non-native alphabet, but regardless of the inconsistency. So it doesn't matter if it's Roman or is ambiguous, that those that are non-native, they are showing this enhancement, which shows us there is a similar orthographic analysis for those non-familiar words, non-native familiar words. And this is indicative of the use of a strategy which is based on whole word form access, which actually is absent for those which are novel, not represented in the lexicon. Actually, those novel words, they only show a script effect in this late time window, as you can see there in the right right part of the graph, the right waveforms. For novel words, there is higher M400 for those presented in the ambiguous script in comparison to the others, whereas for familiar words, they show no differences in M400 between ambiguous and the native ones, those presented in Kyrillic, in Russian. So this shows us the higher effort, the increased effort that these novel words, in the processing of these novel words when they are presented into ambiguous script, which are actually only detected later on during the visual word recognition, during reading, at this around 400 milliseconds, not before. So overall, all of our results, they showed us this inconsistent decoding rules across alphabets actually impact both recognition of both familiar, reading of both familiar and novel words, as previously seen in other studies. This is higher, the impact is higher for novel than for familiar. And we found this both at behavioral, replicating previous findings, but also actually at neurophysiological level, as shown by the higher N400 amplitudes and actually absence of any kind of a detection at earlier stages. And actually, the advantage that familiar words are showing is likely based on the access to this wall form strategy reading, to the access to the orthographic representations for these words, which are actually well known there by these readers. And this access is likely mitigating the impact of this ambiguity across rules, across alphabets. Because if we are able to access to this whole form reading strategy as actually is indexed in the P200 component showed by these conditions, there is no need to follow serial decoding rules, which are actually competing when we use this serial strategy, which actually is the only one that can be used for novel words because they are not yet represented. So the question, next question for our investigation, which is actually going on already, is what is the impact of this inconsistency during the formation, during the representation of these novel words? How is this influencing the orthographic learning process? But this is all that I wanted to share with you for today. So if you have any questions, please, I will be glad to answer. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Beatrice. Yes, we have 4 minutes for questions. Let me see if we have any hands or... or anything in our chat. Any questions, please? It was very clear.
Yeah, looks like, or very fast.
Anything that you would like to add, you can do this now since we have some time.
Well, this is part of an ongoing study. And as I said, we are trying to see what is the effect on novel word learning, which is our primary focus of research. And I hope we can very soon share some results, some publication. So hopefully for next year, we will be able to show this. But not much, I mean, we have, what we can see in our results is that actually a part of this, even despite of this phonological interference, readers are able to create representations regardless of this ambiguity. They create this in a more slow fashion, let's say, but at the end, after just 10 exposures, actually not much, they are able to create representations to form and to access to them. In non-ambiguous conditions, in a more slow fashion, but at the end, the representation is formed anyways. So this is what I can say from other studies that we are conducting in the same kind of line.